Sue Edinger. She's a graduate of Cornell, and she received her accreditation of diplomacy in internal medicine at Animal Medical Center of the University. Dr. Edinger.
Hey, everyone. Tips and tricks for lymphoma. So if you're here this morning, oh, not on. Oh, please. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, much better. I can barely hear myself. Okay, so we're going to talk about tips and tricks for lymphoma in dogs. I recently updated this talk, so hopefully you will find it new and current. This morning, we did cancer cliff notes, and I did lymphoma in 10 minutes, right? 10, 15 minutes. So we're going to try to dive in a little bit more deeply into canine lymphoma, but just realize I've done this lecture as a two-hour lecture, and I could spend 4 hours going through lymphoma, so it's still hard to get everything in 50 minutes, but I'm going to do my best to really hit the highlights and make it very practical for you in practice as we go through this. So, you guys, have most of you been to my lecture so far today? Anyone not been to a lecture today so far? Okay, that's good. So, I mean, not that that's good, but welcome to the party. Woo-hoo. Okay, I get a little crazy towards the end of the day. So please join me on social media. These are some of my favorite hashtags, and I love to give away free stuff. For the people who are new, please take out your phone if you want free stuff and text Dr. Sue as one word to 444-999. Signs you up to my newsletter. I will only send you about one newsletter a month. It will give you when my Q&A is for pet owners, when my office hours are, and my closed Facebook. If you don't get that closed Facebook link, you will get it in the newsletter. You can unsubscribe at any time. At the end of the next lecture, I'll be giving away digital calipers so you can measure lymph nodes in all of your patients and lumps and bumps. And at the end of this talk, I'll be giving away plastic calipers as well. You have to be at the next talk to get the digital calipers. Okay. So lymphoma, I have a love-hate relationship with lymphoma. So who likes lymphoma? I mean, it's okay. Like, you know, let's be honest. Like, it's okay to love lymphoma. Like, I love treating lymphoma. I love how my patients do. I love the relationships that I develop with my clients. But I hate it for so many other reasons. It's so devastating when you make that diagnosis and you have to go in the room and explain everything to the owner. And it's expensive, and there's so many tests, and there's so many different chemotherapy protocols. So I'm going to try to unpack it for you and make it as simple as we can. So let's think about the key points of lymphoma. It's a systemic disease. You know, I've been talking about this all day. It requires chemotherapy in almost all cases. It's really important that we diagnose this cancer early. We want to do careful staging, right? We want to do the right test. But we can spend a lot of money. We can spend $2,000 easily in the Northeast, you know, just doing their staging test. But then we have to treat, so it's a very expensive process to stage it and then treat it. Why do I like treating lymphoma? High response rates. 80 to 90% of dogs will go into remission, so they, you know, very high response rates, up to 90 to 95% with a CHOP multi-agent chemotherapy protocol. Dogs live longer and have improved quality of life. And that's really important, right? Because if numbers are important, these dogs need to feel well, have good quality of life, and do all the things with their families that they were doing before they got sick. I like to treat dogs with lymphoma for some of the things that I mentioned. They feel good as they're going through chemo, they go into remission, and most owners are really happy that they treated. So high response rates have significantly improved survival times. A month versus 13 to 14 months is a long time. It's never long enough for a pet owner. It's not long enough if it's my own pet. But when I look at a month versus 13 to 14 months in the lifespan of a dog, I do think that's a significant improvement. This morning I talked about hemangio. Less than 10% of the dogs survive 1 year. That's really crappy, but I'm okay. I would like them to do better with how dogs do with lymphoma. The other thing is they live well, so chemotherapy is very well tolerated. But as I talked about, there's a lot of chemo options and it can get really overwhelming. So we need to be practical. We're often working on a budget. So we need to be practical with not only our workup, but with our different treatment. Because not everybody can afford a CHOP chemotherapy protocol and every diagnostic under the sun. So I think about lymphoma with what I call my three P's, where we need to pick tests and protocols based on what is prognostic, and we're going to highlight the important risks. But we need to be practical. deductible. Like I said, not everybody can get there weekly, and not everybody has $15,000 to spend on chemotherapy. And we need to be pertinent. And what I mean by that is, what else is going on in the patient that I'm going to change what I might do for the patient I saw the day before with lymphoma? So just so I have a feel, who in the room refers all their cases? Okay. Who recommends an oncologist but will treat if they have to, if the owners won't go? About a third. Who treats in their practice? Okay, probably the most hands. And who does not recommend treating dogs with lymphoma? Still waiting for somebody to be like, or you're just ignoring me. That's okay. All right, so let's break it down. Let's talk about lymphoma. So what is lymphoma? It's cancer arising from the malignant transformation of lymphocytes. I said that a couple of times today because lymphoma has come up. It's a very diverse group of neoplasms. In dogs, it's a little bit more consistent and predictable than it is in cats, as we've talked about today. It's one of the most common cancers that we see in dogs, about 10 to 20% of all cancers that we see in dogs. So this is Maya, one of my favorite cases that I treated. She had a really tough B-cell lymphoma. Most of the dogs, so this is, you know, still only a 50-minute talk. We're going to talk about the multicentric form of lymphoma. We're not going to talk about the GI and the skin forms and the mediastinum. Most of the dogs have peripheral lymph node lymphoma. This accounts for about 80% of the lymphomas we see. Most dogs feel great. They're asymptomatic, so when you walk in the room and tell the owners your dog has lymphoma, it's only going to live a month, you're dropping a bomb on them. It is devastating, and I think that's one of the hardest parts about lymphoma. About 20 to 40% of the dogs are clinical, sub-stage B. But again, it's nothing really crazy, right? They're not eating, they're vomiting, diarrhea, they're tired, you know, they're losing some weight. It's really nothing that's very, very dramatic. You know, some of these dogs have stopped in 13 centimeter lymph nodes. This is a pre-scap lymph node. Most dogs have the aggressive form of lymphoma, usually multicentric, so multiple lymph nodes, usually with liver and splenic involvement. Sometimes you're gonna have that dog that doesn't have any lymph nodes, it's just in the liver and spleen, but usually it's gonna be peripheral lymph node. Usually when you squeeze those lymph nodes, it doesn't hurt them, it's not painful. And again, most of these dogs feel good. The T-cell dogs, those tend to be sub-stage B, those tend to be sicker, and both of those two things are important negative prognostic factors. What do I tell owners? This tends to be similar to non-Hodgkin's lymphoma in people. And that's, you know, something that most people are usually familiar with. Usually, like I mentioned, it involves the liver and the spleen. It probably involves the more lungs than we see, but again, we're not going to be doing bronchial alveolar lavage in most of our cases. But the point is, it probably is involving the lungs, but it's not, you know, metastatic nodules like we think about with other cancers where you're seeing big, you know, big white nodules throughout the lungs. When it is in the lungs, it's going to be diffuse interstitial. So it's going to look like a pneumonia. You know, it can cause a lot of other syndromes, paraneoplastic syndromes with anemia and thrombocytopenia being the most common. And again, some of the other less common ones are listed on the slide. So this is a pretty extensive list of the different extranodal outside of the lymph node places that you can see lymphoma. And what I'd like you to take away from this extensive list is two things. One is, lymphoma goes wherever the heck it wants. You know, in my residency, we often were able to do necropsies on cases, and sometimes we would find it in the urinary bladder. I was like, huh, I didn't really think about lymphoma going to the urinary bladder, but it does. But the other take-home message from this one is the most common extranodal sites that you're going to see are the eyes. So take a good look at the eyes. And so the ocular, and the conjunctiva, this is Jack, who's a case that came in, even I would notice. I'm not very good at eyes. But even I noticed his eyes were bad. But you know, he's definitely quite infiltrated. But some of the studies, so in one study, 94 dogs with lymphoma, 37% had ocular changes. In another study of just over 100 dogs with uveitis, 17% had lymphoma. So again, just other things to think about when you're looking in your patient's eyes. This is Willa, who was this little corgi mix dog that I saw. And when she came in, she was stage 5, so she had circulating lymphocytes, lymphoblasts on her CBC, and then she had this white stuff in the front chamber of her eye. So she had hypopia. So she had ocular changes, and actually after her first dose of chemotherapy, she came back in the next week and her ocular changes had resolved. It was pretty cool. Actually, she finished chemotherapy. She went through CHOP multi-agent chemotherapy. She did really well. She relapsed pretty quickly about a month later. It was hard to get a good picture, but when she relapsed, she actually had hyphema. It's a really weird case to have ocular changes again when she relapsed. But again, the point is just to take a good look at her eyes. All right, so let's talk about diagnostics. First thing you're gonna do is Y-rate aspirate, right? Stick a needle in those lymph nodes. This is a discrete brown cell population that you're gonna see. Why do I like cytology? We get our results back quickly. Doesn't give us grading, doesn't give you all the things that you'll see on biopsy, but for most of our cases, it's gonna be completely accurate. I asked this question this morning, so if you're here, don't answer. Which lymph node should you not aspirate if all of them are big? Charts so I have prioritized. These are the three most important prognostic factors for dogs with lymphoma. B versus T. So dogs that have T-cell lymphoma, it's a negative prognostic factor. Shorter survival time, lower response rates, they don't stay in remission as long. Dogs that are sick, same exact thing. Shorter survival times, lower remission rates, shorter remission duration. Dogs that go into a complete remission do better. Stage, in some studies, stage 3 do better than 4 than 5. It's not as important. Low versus high grade, those are the most important. Hypercalcemia, that's usually associated with being T-cell. So again, I want you to know what the most important prognostic factors are. And again, the number one is B versus T. Okay? So, there are other ones. Prior to chemo is a bad thing. It makes them less likely to respond to chemotherapy. And some of the other ones that you can go through. But again, I want to highlight one of the most important ones. This is why I don't care. Because even if I had $5,000 to run every prognostic test, I couldn't take every result, put it in that formula, and give the owner, your dog's going to live 11.2 months. Your dog's going to live 14.7 months. I'm serious, right? So sometimes I can run all the tests, and I'll tell the owner, well, it's B, and that's good, but your dog is 6. That's not as good. And this. So, you know, it's you just kind of have to, you know, work with what you can and just realize that even if you can run every prognostic factor, it's still hard to ultimately have a crystal ball for our owners. Okay, so why do we care about B cell? What if the owner say, you know what, I can't afford to do B versus T? Assume it's B cell. Don't give the vaccine therapy, but assume it's B, because most dogs are B cell. Again, higher complete remission rates, longer, higher complete remission, longer survival times. They do better. Most high grades are B cell. You see the breeds that we see it in. About 10 to 40% are T cell. Again, complete opposite. They don't go into remission, they don't have as long remissions, and they don't live as long. They're typically hypercalcemic. Can you have a hypercalcemic B cell? Yes. So just because they're hypercalcemic doesn't mean that you should have run B versus T. Okay. This is the second most important prognostic factor. Dog doesn't feel well, right? Okay. It's no. I mean, yes, they're going to. Yeah, so you're still always substage B. It was at the time of diagnosis. And both of the question was, can you become A? So the point is, if you're sick at time of diagnosis, that's a negative prognostic factor. Most dogs will still go into remission and feel good, but statistically they don't do as well as if you were feeling well when you walked in the door. Okay. So I do want to bring up, so in people, when they look at substage, the problem is, like, if the dog comes in and they're like, laterally, or I come in and they're dehydrated and chalky, probably 10 oncologists, 10 dental practitioners are all going to say that dog's substage B, right? Well, what about the dog that just wasn't feeding that well? The problem is substage is not uniformly assigned across veterinarians. In people, they don't do substage. They do something called poor performance, and they look at things like fever, bite slips, weight loss, and inflammatory conditions. And that is a negative prognostic factor in people. So they characterize it a little bit more differently. And again, it's associated with inflammation. And you know, there are things that we know that's associated with inflammatory conditions with lymphoma, like anemia, changes in neutrophils, macrophages, and these acute phase proteins, which have been looked at in lymphoma patients as well. And so I do bring up the fact that there are some cases where I'm like, I think there's some stage, what kind of age? You know, or like, because it's just not as obvious. And so there is definitely issues with the substage system in some cases, and there was a lecture that I went to at the last conference saying that we need something better prognostic than the substage system. So it's not the perfect prognostic factor by any stretch with it, B versus T is. So the other question is, should we do full staging? You know, I was saying, oh, I don't always do chest x-rays, I don't always do bone marrow. I do like to do ultrasound. It would be nice to be able to do chest x-rays. I'd really like to have a baseline, especially for ultrasound, to see the lymph nodes, see the liver, the spleen, to see do they have a lot of disease internally that I can't see and feel on exam. But again, a lot of the times you have to consider what are the owner's financial considerations. You know, and you know, I've had cases come in where they've done chest x-rays and blood work and phenotype and ultrasound, and they go, I have no interest in chemo. Why did you do all these tests? Like, oh, my vet told me I had to. blood and urine. I sent off phenotype. I started him on LFAR prednisone. By the time he came back the next week, we determined he had B cell lymphoma. We did single agent doxorubicin. You know, not the perfect protocol, but definitely a great plan B protocol. We did that every 3 weeks for 6 treatments. And in that time, Dad got to do 2 road trips onto San Diego. I told Dad that, you know, the average dog was 7 to 9 months. Their first remission, you know, is usually shorter, about 6 to 7 months. His first remission was 13 months when he relapsed. We went back onto chemotherapy. We went back onto a lymphoma. We actually had a second road trip out to San Diego. And Dad's joke with me was, you spent more money than you told me it would be. It was a joke. I was like, well, he's still alive. I've been doing it. You know, it was good. But again, this was a great plan B protocol. And then by the time he relapsed, that had saved money. And he was able to afford to put him back on chemotherapy. So that worked for him. So again, that's how I was practical. And again, I picked a protocol based on the fact that he was B cell. And that's a case that I like single agent doxorubicin. Let me tell you about Tate. He's a little bit different. So he was a 7-year-old male castrated chow. He presented to his local vet with polyuria, polydipsia. He was also coughing. His local vet ran some blood work. His ionized calcium was mildly elevated at 1.6, with 1.4 being high normal. Except for the high total calcium on the regular blood work, the CBC came on normal. His urine was diluted. He was sent over to internal medicine in February of 2014. His lymph nodes were just a little bit big. Full disclosure, the internist is my husband. He knows that, you know, dogs is lymphoma. And so he actually, you know, called me on my desk and said, hey, we can feel this dog's lymph nodes. And I was like, yeah, they're a little bit big. So we aspirated the lymph nodes. That was Tank. It was a chow. He was a little bit feisty in the beginning. But he was also coughing, right? So we took chest radiographs in a big mediastinal lymph node. So I told you, I don't know these two chest radiographs in dogs with lymphoma. This dog was coughing. This dog was hypercalcemic. And we know that a lot of dogs with mediastinal that are hypercalcemic often have mediastinal lymphoma, and it also fit with his coughing. So that's one where I was like, you know what? We're going to do chest radiographs. I don't often do them for dogs with lymphoma, but this dog had to be pertinent. I had to change what I needed to do because he had something else going on. So we did chest radiographs. Full disclosure, actually, this was not a monkey. The mom let us do a full workup. Did also do an ultrasound, given a large amount of spleen that was consistent with infiltration of lymphoma. His sublobar lymph nodes were quite big and some age-related kidney changes. We did do lymph node aspirate, sent it off, and also did phenotype on that, and surprise, surprise, came back T-cell lymphoma. We started him on a modified CHOP protocol, so since he had T-cell lymphoma, I'll talk about this in the treatment, I take out the doxorubicin and I put in lymphoma, and he started that the following week. Maybe a couple days later, in February of 2019. So his calcium normalized, his PUPD resolved even on the PrEP and CHOP chemotherapy protocol, got a little neutropenic after being, he completed his chemotherapy protocol 6 months later. So T-cell guys, right? Hypercalcemic, T-cell, sick of time of diagnosis, all negative prognostic factors, right? So what do I tell them for dogs with T-cell lymphoma? Usually 8 to 10 months. Median survival time, lower complete remission rates, usually don't do as well. Okay, so we finished his chemotherapy protocol. Ding! First remission, 26 months. This is why when people say, doc, if it's T-cell, we shouldn't treat, right? No, they can still do well. I have dogs with T-cell lymphoma that hit B-cell lymphoma's butt, and it frustrates you. And it also is really frustrating to have that B-cell lymphoma that relapses 3 months into the middle of their chemotherapy protocol. Like, B-cell's not always good. So, you know, it's not as black and white as we would like it to be. In addition to his exam and lymph node, palpation, when he came in for his exam, I also monitored his ionized calcium during that time period. He relapsed in April of 2016. Normally, their second remission is half the length of their first, so we did put him back in chemotherapy. He was euthanized a couple of months later, so did not go back in remission, did not do well. But again, 2 years, 4 months, not so bad. Again, just a good example. Okay. Yep. Yeah. Yeah, It stains cells with different antibodies that bind to the different proteins of these lymphoma cells. It needs to be done with live cells that are suspended in liquid. That means if you have aspirated a dog's lymph nodes and made slides, and you get back from the lab that it's lymphoma and you saved a couple of slides, that won't work with flow cytometry. You have to submit it in a special solution that you make up. Not special, it's basically sodium chloride and serum from the dog. But it can be done on slides. So that can be a little bit of a challenge. You have to, you know, think ahead for it. And you can't leave it on your shelf for a couple of days while you're waiting for your cytology to come back. So usually that means having the dog come back and you know, doing another sample and sending it off to Colorado overnight. That's why sometimes people do that. But again, in general, I like flow cytometry. And if you go to the CFC website, they tell you exactly how to submit it. But basically, it's 1 mL of sodium chloride in a tube with 0.1 mL of dog serum. It doesn't need to be that dog serum, which kind of freaks me out, but it doesn't have to be. And then you aspirate the dog's lymph node, and you gently put it into that tube, and you rock it back and forth, and you submit it, I think, on ice, and you ship it overnight, and you get the results in a couple of days. It's really easy to do. CSU has a like step-by-step how to do it. That's how I do it. If you, the other option is to do PAR. The nice thing about PAR is if you submitted slides to a lab like Antech, and confirm lymphoma, they can often send those slides to another lab and do PAR off of that. So it is a good option, especially if you've aspirated something on a Friday, you know, and you want to add it on. But I do like flow if I see that the vet has diagnosed a case and they're sending it to me, and I'm going to do flow cytometry if I have my doctors. The nice thing, again, about PAR is you can run it on lots of different things, lymph nodes, CSF, laboratory fluid, stain slides. So it's a little bit more flexible and practical in that sense. And it's basically telling us, are these cells clonal, which means it's cancer, or are they polyclonal, so it's a reactive. The other really good use is, say you have a dog with a really big lymph node, a mandibular lymph node, and you're trying to figure out if this dog has early lymphoma, so this dog made a dental, that's where you're going to use PCR. You can use the PAR as well and aspirate it and send it. Again, it's going to tell you whether it's reactive or it's going to tell you whether it's again, there's a really good information. I would direct you to the CSU website. Basically, you don't have to memorize this chart, but you don't even need to know websites anymore. Just go Colorado State Immunology Lab, and this chart will come up. So if you have a dog that has lymphocytosis, they tell you submit blood for flow. If you have a dog with big lymph nodes, aspirate the lymph node. If you're trying to figure out if it has lymphoma, do flow. In media cytoma mass, you can use lymphoma versus cytoma, submit flow. So again, they tell you when to do PAR, they tell you when to do flow, and all of this information is on their website. Okay. All right, let's get into treatment, because I know that's what you guys want. All right, so there's really a couple different treatment modalities when we think about lymphoma, but the main one is chemotherapy. Now, there's four places in the U.S. that I know of that are doing bone marrow transplants, like NC State. Immunotherapy, you know, this is huge in people. Rituximab has been so important, monoclonal antibodies, improving their response rates for people with lymphoma, but we don't really have anything on the market, so we're not going to really talk about that. There were the monoclonal antibodies that were available in clinical trials for a couple of years, but they were not shown to be effective. And then radiation has some really good use in some cases, but really chemotherapy is the main thing that we're going to be talking about. It's the mainstay of therapy. So the goal is a complete and durable remission of at least greater than 6 months. So again, with the CHOP chemotherapy protocols being the most successful, complete remission of 80-90%. First remission is usually 9-10 months, and usually the median survival is about 13-14 months. About 25% of dogs are long-term survivors. What's nice about lymphoma is the dogs have very high response rates. They achieve complete remission. Here's Calvin running as a 14-year-old dog running on the beach in South Carolina in the middle of his chemotherapy. So these dogs have great quality of life as they're going through chemo. And again, owners are very happy that they treat if they decide to treat. And they can always stop if they're not happy with how their pets are doing. So that's why, again, remember I said I love treating lymphoma. It's a very rewarding cancer to treat because these dogs tolerate it and do really well. And a lot of these owners that initially say, no, I will never poison my dog, give them a day or two. They often change their mind. People are smiling. And they do. They often change their mind, and they do treat, and they're happy that they did. It's just such a shocking cancer. But again, let's break it down, because there's so many different protocols out there. So again, when I think about it again, I keep going back to my three things. So let's talk about what's prognostic. Phenotype. I change my protocol, whether it's B versus T. That's why I picked, that's another reason I want to determine that. So we'll talk about that. If they're sick, I maybe need to add more supportive medications if they're sick in the beginning. And again, the protocol itself, CHOP is going to be better than Lomusti. So again, the protocol itself is going to be prognostic. What's going on with the patient? If the dog has a huge tumor burden, they're more likely to be sick from the treatment. You're going to need to give them more supportive medications in the beginning. Does the dog have an arrhythmia? Does the dog have dilated cardiomyopathy? Doxorubicin might not be the choice. Do you want to use Lomustine in a dog with liver toxicity? Again, what is going on in the patient that you need to be thinking about that when you pick your protocol? And then the other thing is, how much money can the owner spend? How often can they come in? And how much toxicity are they willing to accept? Some owners are okay with giving medications and some toxicity, and some owners, like if the dog doesn't eat once or twice, they're done, and that's okay. I'm not there to judge. I just need to find the right protocol that's on par with what they want. Totally overwhelming, right? Okay. Totally overwhelming, right? I just tried to put pretty colors on it to make it better. Okay. So they call it, lymphoma like the alphabet soup of protocols. So CHOP, University of Wisconsin. Look at this, complete remission rates, really, really high, 94%, 13 to 14 months is the median survival time. VELCAP for comparison is a tough multi-agent protocol. The dogs that went into complete remission did well. A little bit more toxicity, that's why most people don't use it. Just so you know, there are other multi-agent chemotherapy protocols. Your local oncologist may use a different multi-agent chemotherapy protocol, and that's okay. Dogs that get half body radiation do a little bit better. That in this talk. Remember Miles, he had B-cell lymphoma? Owners didn't want to do CHOP, so I did this protocol. Why? 60 to 80% complete remission rate with a median survival time of 7 to 9 months. He did much better than that. That's my next favorite protocol for a dog with B-cell lymphoma. We'll talk a little bit about Tanovia, which is that new lymphoma drug. Pretty similar up there. If you alternate the two, it looks like we can do a little bit better, so this is becoming a nice option. But Tanovia is going to be more expensive than just doxorubicin alone. CHOP is a nice protocol, a little bit lower in complete remission, and it goes on for about a year, so I don't end up doing most of that. Mido is not a good option. Lomustine, you can see, there's not a lot of papers using it as a first-line protocol. I think it's reasonable if someone was asking if owners don't want to do injectable chemo, but there's not a lot of papers supporting it as a first-line therapy, and that they'll have high remission rates and survival times. But again, it's a reasonable option. But again, the response rates are not as high. PRED is good, but again, usually I would say 1 to 2 to 3 months is going to be the response, and your treatment's usually about a month. Okay? All right. So this chart's probably a little bit more practical because I kind of took out the stuff that most of us aren't doing. So again, we have CHOP, doxorubicin, Tanovia, the new chemotherapy drug. Alternating Tanovia with doxorubicin improves the complete remission rate, about a 6 to 7 month progression-free interval. And I'm sorry, guys, different studies look at survival times versus how long they're in remission or not. So sometimes it's not consistent study to study. CHOP, Lomustine, and PRED, new treatment. Okay, I think that's a sort of more practical summary. Okay, so again, the CHOP protocol, there's a 25-week, there's a 19-week. I like the 19-week, but again, really high remission rates. Dogs that go into remission and then relapse and go back on the protocol have really high second remission rate. It doesn't have a maintenance phase. So it's usually a 5 or 6 month chemotherapy protocol. When they graduate, they're off chemotherapy, and then when they relapse, they go back on. So that's what I mean by the maintenance. The older chemotherapy protocols were like a year or longer. There are still some chemotherapy protocols out there that have maintenance phase on it. But as a people, it's really thought that they don't need the maintenance phase. Okay, so I told you I do change my protocol. If they're B-cell and the owner has money, I'm going to do a CHOP chemotherapy protocol. If the owner doesn't want to do something sort of a little bit more reasonable, I'm going to do single agent doxorubicin for 6 doses. If they're a small dog, I'm going to dose them at a mg per kg. Another option would be doxorubicin alternating with tenobium, 3 of each for a total of 6. Again, tenobium is a new drug. It's going to be a little bit more expensive, but again, it looks like that's going to have a better response rate. And then COP would be another option. What would that be a good option for? Maybe you have a dog that can't get doxorubicin, right? Because they have arrhythmia, or they have dilated cardiomyopathy. What about my T-cell? So remember Tank? This is my modified CHOP protocol. I take out doxo and I put in lomusti. We know that those dogs don't do as well if they get doxorubicin. We know that doxo doesn't work as well for T-cell dogs. So this is a non-published study. I can tell you that statistically they do better, but this is what I do with my dogs. If they have T-cell and the owner doesn't want to do multi-agent chemo, I will do either single-agent lomusti, I will do a MOP protocol, or sometimes I'll alternate lomustine with vincristine. No standard of care for T-cell dogs. Again, for oncologists in the room, 6 different opinions. Usually divided by 4. Okay. So again, we don't know what's optimal for dogs with T-cell. Okay. So how many of you were in the lecture before? Okay. How many of you weren't in the lecture before? Okay, it's a good number. Okay, good review for the people who were in the lecture before. Sorry, guys. So this is Tenobia. This is this new drug. This is Nettie Spaghetti, who was the first patient that I gave Tenobia. So Tenobia is a brand new drug that was just approved. It's conditionally approved. That means you cannot use it off-label. Do not use it for other cancers. It has a very generous label, meaning you can use it for, and I'll go through, you know, B-cell, T-cell lymphoma, newly diagnosed, and relapse. A very generous label. It's an IV drug. It's been shown to have complete and acceptable safety and reasonable effectiveness, but they have 5 years to continue to show its effectiveness, and then hopefully it will be fully licensed, and then you can use it off-label. Just like palladium, guys. Remember palladium was officially licensed, and you couldn't use it off-label, but now you can use it for, you know, everything under the sun, which I did. But that's another option. If you're not giving chemotherapy, this wouldn't be my training wheel drug. You know, again, it's a cytotoxic drug. You want to be careful. So it's indicated for lymphoma, you can use it for B-cell, you can use it for cutaneous, you can use it for T-cell, you can use it for GI lymphoma, low-grade, high-grade, and again, they can have seen other chemotherapy. So first-line and or relapse. In their studies, they did not use serenia, they did not use prednisone, they did not use diarrhea medication, but it's legal under the conditional approval to use that. So like I said, it has very generous. So the recommended dose is a mg per kg every 3 weeks for 5 doses. It's given as a 30-minute infusion. If they have side effects, they recommend going down to 0.8 and then 0.66 mg per kg. Do dose delay just like you would other, you know, chemotherapy treatments if they're having significant side effects. In the initial study, about a 77 overall response rate. Not bad, right? The other thing to remember with this, guys, is that there were newly diagnosed lymphomas and relapsed lymphoma patients. We know that patients that have seen other drugs are harder to get into remission and have response rates. And those are going to drag those numbers down than if you're just giving it to newly diagnosed lymphoma. So usually dogs will have a response by day 7. In the original study, most dogs responded for about 4 months. The dogs that were pre-treated with other chemotherapy was shorter, and that makes sense. And the cool thing about this, thinking about our CHOP multi-agent chemotherapy, and these were dogs that only had to come in every 3 weeks for 5 doses. How many treatments do they get in CHOP? Like 15, right? So again, this is a reasonable option, you know, for another owner that doesn't want to come in, or if you're looking for something for your relapse patients. So it was generally very well tolerated. When you look at this, it looks like one of those commercials that you see with all the different side effects. A couple of take-home messages. GI side effects seem to be the most significant. When I was first giving Nettie, I was scared. Like, I was giving a new drug. I was like, oh my gosh, you're going to get sick? Her mom was so scared because Nettie had GI issues with vincristine and doxorubicin. And so I called my colleague, Frank Clifford, and he said, prolonged anorexia is the most severe side effect I've ever seen. So I'm very proactive with her GI medications with that. So I give IV serenia with it, just like I would doxorubicin. And then for the 6 days after chemotherapy, I have every owner automatically give serenia daily and in text. And I have not seen much side effects, GI side effects with that. The other thing is that it's against the label to give to Westies. because they can have pulmonary fibrosis, and that is a breed that is predisposed. And there have been reports of pulmonary fibrosis in some other breeds as well. So you should be monitoring these patients with periodic chest radiograms. Most of your side effects, you know, like neutropenia and GI side effects, you're going to, you know, with typical supportive therapy that you would for your other chemotherapy. And then the other thing that I mentioned is there's this interesting study that came out in 2017. These dogs, the other thing is this is now first-line therapy. These dogs did not see other therapy, so they're not pre-treated with other chemo. These are newly diagnosed lymphoma, and they're going to alternate doxorubicin and tenobia. So the cool thing about that is they have different mechanisms of action, so both given at typical doses of 8 per kg and 30 mg per meter squared every 3 weeks, moderate and self-limiting side effects, and an 84% response rate. So that's even better. And that's what you would expect. If each drug individually has efficacy, you would expect that if you alternate that it's going to do better. That's why multi-agent does better than single-agent toxin, and why single-agent lomustine, right? You're attacking the cancer cells from multiple angles. Median progression-free interval was about 6 months. Dogs that went into complete remission did better. But again, this is pretty comparable to multi-agent chemotherapy. Not quite as good, but still a good option. And this study, or this slide, is just to show you that VetDC, which is a company that is producing Tenobia, you know, and this is really different than the lymphoma vaccine, is they're doing a lot of clinical studies. They're doing a lot of studies to really show safety and efficacy, and I think that's one of the reasons why you're seeing Tenobia get incorporated into practice much more quickly. So conclusion so far, it's active for both your newly diagnosed and your relapsed patient. Very broad label. We talked about, you know, you can use it with concurrent medications, recommended every 21 days. It's efficacious, it's convenient. The other thing, and I think this makes sense, don't wait to use it as your fourth relapse, right? It's probably not going to work as well. So for me, I'm now going to it as my first relapse. So if, after the relapse from CHOP, if the urine doesn't want to go back on CHOP, I'm using Tenobia. If the urine doesn't want to do CHOP multi-agent chemotherapy, I'm offering Tenobia alternating with doxorubicin. And again, be very proactive. With GI side effects, and they're also, we talked about the pulmonary fibrosis. Some dogs will have a dermatopathy, like itchy skin. So some oncologists will bring them on low dose pred after 1 week per day preventatively. Usually we'll do it as needed. And a pivotal trial, some more studies coming. And there's Nevi. Okay, so again, just budget options. If you have that B cell dog that doesn't want to do CHOP, you do single agent doxorubicin. If they have a little bit more money in their budget, I would think it would be a little bit better to do Tenobia alternating with doxorubicin. If I have a T cell dog or a B cell dog that can't afford to do the above, I would do single agent lomustine. Maybe you want to add preg to that protocol, but maybe that will improve their survival time. And I don't really care if it's BOT if the urine just responds to steroids. Alright. That's really the fourth piece. So, prednisone, not to be forgotten. I think, you know, no dog that is not getting treated with chemotherapy should not get some prednisone. There's actually a cool study, I think it was 2015. You know, oncologists are always like, they need their pred, we gotta have pred. This study showed dogs kind of did the same without the pred. I still use pred in the beginning, but if I have a dog that I need to taper off more quickly because they're having side effects, I like it because they feel better. They're eating better in the beginning of their protocol, but if I have a diabetic, I'm happy to skip their pred. And I think it's nice to know that they do okay according to this one study without their steroids. So again, I think it's okay to eliminate it. And again, I know, you know, I harp on this and I talked about this in some of the other lectures. There are cases where you break the news that they have lymphoma and the owner says, I'm never going to give chemotherapy, so you send them home with steroids, or they're not eating well, so you give them steroids to stimulate their appetite, and the lymph nodes go back to normal and the owner changes their mind, right? And then they come in to see me and I tell them that if they've been on steroids, it makes chemotherapy less effective, and they're angry. They're not angry at you, they're just angry in general because their dog has cancer. So it's really important to remember that a lot of the times owners change their mind just because they're so overwhelmed. And the other thing is, if you put them on steroids, and then I want to do flow, or you want to do flow, or we want to do an ultrasound, we've already started to treat the cancer. So again, just make sure that the owner really isn't, you know, considering chemo at all. What do you do if they're not eating? while you're waiting for your aspirate to come back. Try Entyce, try Serenia. We have other things that you can do. So again, they usually increase the survival to about 2 to 3 months with a 50% response rate. Will I still treat them with chemo if they've been on steroids? Yeah, of course I will. But one of my colleagues calls it a one-way street. So ideally, we'd like for them not to see steroids before their chemotherapy. Again, it makes their chemo less effective, so it causes something called multi-drug resistance. How do I dose these dogs that are just going on steroids? 30 mg per meter squared once a day for 2 weeks, and then about 20 mg per meter squared indefinitely. Of course, remind the owner that they should never just stop it. We have to taper, but usually I'll keep them on indefinitely. When they relapse, why do they relapse? Basically, I call it survival of the fittest. We never kill all of the lymphoma cells. There are some clones. I was earlier talking about Star Wars. There are clones that emerge and rise up, and those are the cells that get stronger and stronger, and they stop responding to chemotherapy. Also, inadequate dosing. Lowering the chemotherapy dose too low will cause relapse because you're making these cancer cells stronger. I have an owner who said, I'd like to take chemo every 6 weeks. That's more likely to cause resistance and relapse as well. So again, when they relapse, typically if they've gone through the CHOP chemotherapy protocol, I would put them back on the protocol if they are willing to. I tell the owners, I've mentioned this, 50% of the dogs will go back into remission. Usually their second remission is halfway length of their first. So if their first remission was 14 months, the second remission is usually about 14 months. If they go back on CHOP, it's usually longer. But again, that's just a rough guideline. When they relapse, some, especially if they go back onto CHOP, will experience good long-term second remissions. One thing to remember is they get 4 doxorubicins in the first CHOP chemotherapy protocol. We max out at 6 due to a cardiotoxicity, so if you're going through the CHOP chemotherapy protocol again, you only want to give 2 more and then you want to switch to something else. Maybe you want to switch to mitoxantrone. It'll be interesting to see if we see Tenobia go into the protocol. This is just some of the rescue protocols that are out there. Basically, I just want you to notice that the complete remission rates for the rescue protocol and how long they go into remission definitely are shorter for these other protocols. I know we're running out of time, but again, these are just some of the rescue protocols. I'll do CHOP if the owners will let me, Tenobia, MOP, and then lomustine with ELSPAR and CRED is another good option that was recently reported to be a good rescue. So that was my summary. We talked about that, just kind of reviewing now where Tenobia fits into this protocol. And, oh, look, we made it to the end. Okay, so why do we aspirate, guys? Really, really important. This is one cancer that we want to get early diagnosis, really get the lymph node aspirates. Think about what's prognostic, B versus T. Are they sick? Pick the important test, work with the owner's budget. Don't give steroids before chemotherapy, if at all possible. Remember, these dogs live longer and they live well, so we have high response rates. Most dogs, 80 to 90% have achieved complete remission, significantly improved survival times. A month versus 13 to 14 months is definitely significant in my opinion. These dogs live well, chemotherapy is well tolerated, 80% of dogs have no side effects as they go through chemo. They're usually free of their clinical signs and significantly improved, I'd say good to great quality of life as they're going through chemo. And there's a lot of options for every budget as we went through. All right, so I will give away a couple pair of calipers. That's the closed Facebook group. If you want to join, it's for vet professionals only. And that's where, guys, if you have a question, a case that you would like to ask me, I would encourage you to put it in the group because that way other people can learn from it. And to be honest, I check this more than I get my email. You don't want to see my email inbox. I am going on vacation after this this meeting, so I probably won't be looking at this quite so much. But I'll be back in a day. So anyway, but do that. Oh, I need my phone. And thank you so much, guys. I hope you enjoyed it.
I did not.